Hi, welcome to the Core Communities June meeting. Today is the 12th of June. We usually do it on Tuesdays. Unfortunately, there were other things that we had to do yesterday, some of which I think Amar would be speaking when he talks about the first agenda item. And so this is where we are. This is being recorded for those who can not join this today and want to catch up with the meeting items later. This will be posted to the DUA YouTube channel and then shared on social media. So we've got a very small set of things to cover today. The review of work done in the past month, this is usually done by Amar with Taras chipping in. The second item is about new runtimes for Cord, which came about because Satish wanted to speak over the new runtimes that is there. And that's very exciting. And with any other topic that anyone on the call wants to bring up, I have something that I would want to just put in 1 minute or 2 minutes at the very end of it. This is the page, by the way, where the community meeting recordings and all of that would be linked. So with that, I'm going to stop the share and ask Amar to kind of give us a quick review of what all stuff has happened in the past month.
Hey, thank you, Sankarshan. So aligning with me, the regular tradition, right? So the last month, we saw majorly the developments were focused on getting Cord into both permission, private, and like how enterprises would run the chain, right? So there were multiple requests which were there to run it with different configurations. Hence, we were brainstorming. Maybe a little bit of whiteboarding, which will reflect in the documentation soon. So on how do we do it with multiple configurations, and how do people take it to different with different, what do you say, finalities to different timings for or the block creation and things like that. So that was a major part of it. I think most of the development work done in the last month is all by Satish, which he will talk through soon. But other than that, one of the issues we saw and quickly touched last week was a witness as a concept, as a palette, which the PR exists. It has made it into a separate branch for a demonstration purpose, which happened yesterday, which, as Sankarshan said, we call it witness because today in the physical world, a document is normally signed by multiple parties in certain scenarios. For example, a land record transferring or things like that. So they are called as witnesses. So their photo is taken, their thumbprint is taken, and that is recorded with the document. So when we visualized it beyond, okay, how do we do that on a blockchain? We thought, okay, hey, it's a good idea to add reference of witnesses also in the chain. So that's how this palette happened. It is not a feature yet in the main branches as in develop branch, but there is a branch called DMP 2024 which has this feature. So other than that, mostly the regular testing enhancements, which many contributors did through C4GT, continued. Multiple PRs on that got merged. So, and there was one other palette which was there, which is called asset tokenization, which in which there were some, over the period of testing it, we found certain issues, as in bugs, I would say. They got fixed. So that is more stable version now. So all of this, whichever is the latest in develop, is available with Confidex Alpha network right now for you to test, and also the SparkNet network, which is available. So yeah, that's the update from me. Thank you. And I think you can take it back, and I think Satish can talk about his work, which has been done, which is.
About this witness thing, I think Adi had posted his own thoughts about what happened at the event yesterday and all that. And dig up the link from LinkedIn, and those who want can take a look at it and paste it in the chat so that it can get into the meeting notes as well. Alrighty. The exciting part of this month, I guess, new runtimes. Go ahead.
You need to enable screen sharing.
You know what? I figured out how to enable screen sharing specifically. I just made you co-host. You should be able to do this, I guess.
Yeah, that should be good.
Okay. So portion of the screen and what does
no portion of the screen is going to be very interesting. No? All I see is a bunch of color and some a part of a terminal, I think.
Yeah, let me just figure out the Zoom way of doing it. Ah, okay. Found it, hopefully.
No.
Okay.
That's a slide deck we are seeing. Is that supposed to be it?
Yeah,
yeah.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. So I think as Amar pointed out, I think the major motivation in doing something like this is based on the feedback that we have been receiving on from customers on the code base for the code project, right? In terms of like, yes, it does have a lot of features already been built in. It is built using Substrate, so we inherit a lot of modularity that is coming from Substrate, and it also has a large connect to the ecosystem so that we can always compose various kind of blockchain networks with different kind of features, different kind of customizations, and all those things is quite possible. But even though it is doable, it's not an easy process, right? In terms of creating a new runtime, it is a quite involved process. And once you create a runtime, you need to make sure that you always keep it updated as the code versions kind of get the updates. So you need to make sure that every runtime that's been created using code should also be updated so that they can actually make use of the latest updates or developments, right? So one of the things that we thought is, why don't we kind of create a few templates or kind of default runtimes that can actually have different properties, right? So that can become a starting point depending on what the user wants to actually do with code. I'll get to the details of in terms of how we split this separately. But before we get to the actual runtime, it is good to kind of recollect in terms of what a code node will look like, right? So the node architecture is basically split into two sides. So one is like the runtime, which we call the Wasm runtime or the state machine. That's a Wasm blob that is that's compiled and that can be uploaded to a chain. So that's one part of the chain. The second part of the code node is the client or the binary itself that actually make sure that that's a native binary that has been compiled and built. It manages everything that the node has to manage in terms of storage or network connections, mempool, and there's also been the client side of it, or this the meta protocol that we called. This is also been known as host, right? So there are two parts to the network, to the node. One is a host, which actually deals with all the hardware interactions of managing storage, network, etc. And then we have the actual runtime, which is a Wasm blob, which we also refer as a protocol or frame or a state transition machine. So that's how a code node has been structured, right? So when we talk about custom runtime, what we are talking about is we having different Wasm configurations, Wasm runtime configuration. Like the node doesn't change or the host doesn't change. The host remains the same because that is taking care of all the default capabilities or the default functionalities of what a blockchain node should do. But yes, there are different configurations to build different Wasms, right? So, and you have the ability to load a particular Wasm when you start the node, right? So that's how we support a multi runtime. So in terms of the runtime, I think, yeah, we currently have added support for three runtimes. I think the first two, the Braid and Loom, is already there. Weave is in progress, I think. So let's go by each one of them, right? So Braid is a runtime. This, when I say runtime, just refer it as like this is a Wasm runtime that I'm talking about. So there is no change. All three runtimes share the same host definition. So a lot of features are same when it comes to managing a network or interacting with the network. The Wasm runtime is the one that changes. So Braid is really a runtime that is focused on enterprise networks, right? And these are networks that can run within an enterprise, which might be used for various use cases where the data sharing happens between different applications or different departments internally, where they want to kind of take some make use of the code data management properties. So this has typically been visualized as a small to medium sized enterprise network where one entity kind of runs it for their own supporting their own use cases. So it's a permission network, which means that anybody who's transacting with the network need to be a member of the network. Only authorized nodes can connect to this network, and this field has a fieldless transactions and things like that. There's also by default, a lot of palettes are already been loaded into the runtime, so that things like identifiers, James space, the statement store is the one that actually stores the credential proof and things like that are part of the Braid runtime. So the second one is it's a step beyond the enterprise network. So we call it the ecosystem network. So this is where you have multiple enterprises or multiple institutions coming together to run a network where the nodes will be distributed. It is not kind of consolidated into one data center or one infrastructure. It runs on hybrid infrastructure. It's basically the infrastructure of choice when it comes to each institution. And they all run their own nodes on their infrastructure, but it all connects together and run an ecosystem-wide network. Now, this also is a permission network configuration by default. Yes, it can be changed to permissionless, but is by default configured as a permission network. So many of the Braid properties also come to Loom. In addition to the Braid properties, one of the key features that get added into Loom is on-chain governance, because since there are multiple institutions involved in ecosystem networks, a lot of this network governance, when it comes to taking multiple decisions, including, adding a new member or upgrading to the latest runtime, all those things can be actually routed through on-chain governance module. So yes, the ecosystem or the Loom runtime has the as on-chain governance in addition to all the features that we see on the Braid system, right? So Weave is the third runtime that is basically a backend for a permissionless network that we're planning to launch later this year. This is a permissionless network, and we envision this to be a global network where the various participants can join, and it does have all the features like Loom in terms of on-chain governance and all the capabilities that is out there. And so this is a network that we're planning to launch sometime later this year. But yes, we expect the Weave runtime to be ready maybe in another 45 days is what we expect. So the runtime, the code base today have all three configuration. Braid and Loom, we'll say that again, it is something that you can start playing with today. Weave at the moment is just a dummy implementation, or it kind of reflects maybe what has already been there in Braid and Loom. It is not completely turned into a permissionless network yet, and that's a change that we are making right now. So you can kind of check out the code base and start playing with it, right? So that's all on the presentation side. I can quickly spend some time walking through some of the code base elements. Okay, what changed when you look into the code base and what need to be looked into. I think I can quickly take you through that. So need to check whether we have time for that.
Yeah, we do. Okay.
Okay, so let's see. Famous. So we look into the what is the font visible?
A little bit more zoomed in wouldn't be bad.
Yeah.
Okay. Is this better?
Yeah.
This is at least readable. Yeah.
Readable. Okay. I can go a bit more as well. Okay.
This will be helpful. Yes.
Okay. So let's look at the directory level or the structure level changes. So the major change happens on the runtime directory, where we now have four separate sections. So the common kind of host all the code that is common across all the common configuration elements that is shared across all the runtime. So typically things like payment handling or network handling, some of those things get added to common. So Braid will have all the configuration details about Braid specific configuration. So if you look into the Braid runtime definition, you'll get to know that, okay, these are the palettes or these are the features that are enabled and on Braid runtime. So when I say a runtime is separate, it kind of packages the runtime definition and the constants and all those things as a separate module within the code base. So if you're planning to make any changes to the Braid or add some features to Braid, yes, and that is not something that need to be added to other runtimes, yes, then those are directory that you should be playing with. And common is something that you touch on when you add common functionalities or you define APIs. Different kind of APIs like the palette APIs or palette runtime APIs. If you define some of the APIs and that APIs need to be available across all runtimes, I think, yeah, this is a place to come and define those APIs out there. And then similarly, the same structure has been followed on Loom and Weave as well. So this is where most of the changes, I think this separation happens. Now, this has been done in a way that, again, the directories are out here. And then when it comes to the node side of things, like going from runtime to the node, there we don't carry different definitions. So it is a one node definition. But at the same time, yes, there are places where the runtimes differ in certain functionalities, even at the node level. For example, like something might have additional palettes, which might have additional Genesis configurations, and somebody one has, say, a permissionless network might have tokenization into that. So there could be some of the additional parameters that need to be added to some of the node specification, but we don't need to kind of create a separate directories or separate modules for each runtime, because that could be a real overkill if we go in that way. So another change, if you kind of look into things like change spec or command line, so one of the things that we started adding is we're defining the feature flags, kind of defining a particular runtime, so a runtime feature. So it's by that, the code really knows that, okay, look, how to compile this or how to execute when you're running a particular runtime, right? Okay, which part of the code need to be activated when you run a particular runtime. So this is all like, okay, the changes out there. So the things to keep in mind is when you're adding a new feature, if it goes across all runtimes, and if it is a common thing, maybe the ideal location to add that feature could be common within the runtime, or if it is very specific to a particular runtime, you add it out there. Now, one other change that happened along with this process is we moved into cargo workspace configuration, which basically means that there is one location that we define all the dependencies that we have, and then we kind of inherit that into every directory. When it comes to every directory, we kind of refer it from the workspace that we have. So this make it easy to kind of manage all the dependencies and the version updates and all those things. And we kind of run less into macro issues and other things while compiling things. So coming from there, I think, yeah, so the changes that are required mostly are in the areas of defining runtime, customizing node with the feature set. And then we come to the final side of things about how do we invoke this, right? Because yes, it's a straightforward invocation if you're doing using the --- chain feature and kind of passing the relevant chain spec, it kind of start up that node, but that won't help during the development time, because at development time, if you want to kind of start a particular development node with a particular configuration, you need to have support for that, right? So you should be able to kind of say that I'm going to run Braid runtime, but started on a single node mode on my laptop. Now, a typical configuration, I think the previous capabilities only included like the development node can be activated only on one runtime. So that's some of the changes. We changed that to support multi runtime now. And some of those changes actually went into command, where we now support additional runtime parameter to be passed. So if we go to starting code, again, remain the same. So we can have an additional runtime parameter which can be passed on when we kind of start the node. So if we start a node with just code and like previously, so this command also continue to work. It kind of defaults to Loom as a runtime. It defaults Loom as a runtime. But if we can pass in, say, a Weave, could be Loom particular runtime, we can specify a particular runtime. So this is mostly for the dev node activation on the within the node or within the laptop. The other things will continue to work, which say that if you want to go a chain -- bread local. So default, I think this is the behavior. Like if I activate -- chain with a bread dev, it starts a node, but it starts a node as a full node where it waits for other nodes to join the network and form the network, right? It does not enable that force ordering and things like that so that it can actually start finalizing things with the node and you get the development experience that you're looking for. Now, let me stop there and see if there are any questions.
Okay.
Don't look like there are questions.
Okay, so
no, I think it is. It is good to, for developers to play with it and yeah. Then feel it because I see. See, I think it is good. I remember even in Polka, it is not so simple with adding a runtime configuration in the command line so easily. So maybe that's a very handy addition. So good. As a Weave or Loom or something as a addition, right? So that's a good thing. I'll check the runtime config and by running it. I think that is a activity which is pending anyway.
Yeah.
So the question now will be, while chain side is done, so majorly considering we have some developers in the call, what are the major changes pending in the SDK side? How do we pick it up? How do we do the or pick up any changes or to help in fast tracking it?
So I think from a roadmap point of view, I think we definitely need to solve one more thing before we start with the SDK side is kind of figuring out the key management or the identity side of things in a way that how these runtimes are going to use identities, be it the DIDs or how do we actually do various kind of key management? And when I say key management, those key management can actually produce maybe a DID if there is a request to create a DID document out of it, right? So we might need to spend some time in kind of figuring that out. And the major work on the SDK that I can foresee is kind of keeping one SDK to support multiple runtimes again, because each runtime has a different set of features, and palettes attached to it. So making sure that it can be figure out a mechanism by which yes, we make it easy for developers to use the SDK with any runtime of their choice. So transitioning that to multi runtime is definitely something that is doable. Third, maybe a good to have thing is also looking at implementing a client that is using SubXT, which is the REST API, because that is that could be a good thing to have as well. In addition to core.js, having a REST-based API is also a good addition to have. So I think some of the things I forgot to touch upon is a couple of major addition to the runtimes in terms of features is, yes, now all the runtimes has smart contract support. The ink support is built in. So as there are people on the call who are familiar with smart contracts, I think we can start playing around with it or start creating example contracts so that other developers can start playing with the chain by loading those contracts. And it can support both ink contracts or and the Solidity ones, like compiling both into WASM, I think using Solang, yes, those contracts can be done. The second major addition to the runtime is the upstream asset module. I think this is something that is becoming default in Substrate in a way that this assets will hold all the balances in the near future, and it becomes a core part of the payment ecosystem or transaction payment ecosystem within the Substrate code base. So so we have the asset and the upstream asset and smart contracts as modules also getting included in code.
Thank you.
Right. Okay. With that, I think I'll get back to Sangarshan if there are no questions.
Okay. I think the other thing that we had on the agenda is if anyone had specific items they wanted to bring up, if we called any other business. So I'll wait for half a minute to see if there is any other business that needs to be brought up, and if folks are interested in bringing us. And share something that I read this week and I found it interesting. So the Project Liberty folks, along with the blockchain governance folks, released what they call a blockchain governance toolkit. I'll post a link to this in the chat if I can find the chat. Yeah, there it is.
Okay.
And it is an interesting read. I think you might be seeing the PDF render loaded on the browser now, right? A massively red page.
Yes. Okay. We do see that.
Yeah, so it's not an extensive document, 41 pages. It is written as a cookbook for those who are familiar with the term cookbook of programming languages and that is to be published by Oracle. So it has that kind of a quick on-ramp of the idea. So I'll just show this part and the rest, if anyone is interested, they can read that. So the executive summary is that the way they're looking at blockchain governance is that they've created what I call some kind of a governance trilemma, that you essentially are configuring blockchains to do a trade-off between these three things: expediency, immutability, and determinism. And these further down the document kind of shapes all the choices that you make. So once you are familiar with these three important parts of it, then they go down to the part that they build out some foundational primitives around terms of how you can have a kind of voting constitution and all of that. So there's obviously on-chain voting, on-chain signaling, and blah, and consensus. Then they come about with how to ensure that some of these safeguards are actually put in place in a blockchain. And then the fourth step is essentially how you deploy with all of this and be able to take some feedback, iterate, and make things more tight and refined. And fifth is basically if you, once you have the governance and all, you can define, you can also look at things like blockchain governance architectures that are, or models that are prevalent, like DAOs and others, to be able to help you run the governance of the blockchain in a more long-term structured manner that has legal standing as well. So this is the overview. Obviously, there's far more around it. It's a good document that I felt reading through it. One of the challenges that I had with this document is that it kind of ignores the impact of the selection of a blockchain and the design of the implementation being influenced by the use case of the ecosystem. And which essentially, I think, is something we are learning as Cord is getting adopted into various ecosystems, and that some of the features that are coming up are being influenced through a feedback loop that is inherently making Cord evolve to a maturity model. And I think that is a part that kind of is ignored in the cookbook, because that part is not very well highlighted. The other part that is not very well highlighted and captured is that every ecosystem brings in its own risks, and the entire design of governance of a blockchain and how it is implemented in code is actually an attempt to understand, identify, and mitigate those risks. So these are the two items that they did not cover. Hopefully, they might end up doing it at some point or not. But that's it. I'd recommend this as a readout for 44 pages, of which actually 10 pages is padding text. The introductory text, participants, and there is all sorts of random stuff at the end. So max of 30 pages that you need to go through with a topic that should be very familiar to anyone who's dabbling in the blockchain space. It's a that's all that I wanted to highlight. We'll wait a bit more. If anyone has anything else to begin before we do this to a close.
Yeah, this is good stuff. I think that's something that we can learn going through it, and maybe probably explore an opportunity to join the foundation as well.
Yeah. It's always difficult to kind of try and capture everything into 30 pages, given how vast and complex the topic of governance is. But anyway, okay, if we have nothing else to discuss today, thank you so much for joining. We will be posting this recording and all of that to our YouTube links as well. And let me save this ad before I forget. And the next month's meeting is scheduled as we generally do on the second Tuesday of the month. If you joined this meeting through the registration process, you would have been able to download a calendar file to add to your calendar. Otherwise, the link over here in the Cord wiki has ways for you to practice. Thank you so much for joining. I think we can call this a meeting by me figuring out how to stop the recording, and that's found the button.